Welcome back to A Beautiful Game. This is part 5, and we're going over the Solaris scene setup, how you would arrange your scene in Solaris for rendering, how you can set up your lights, and some of the new features that you can find within Solaris for Karma. Right, so let's go ahead and open up part 5 solarisscene.hip, and we can dive inside of that file. If we take a look at what we have, we just have this set to the Solaris desktop, and we have a LARP network. Inside of here, we have what is called full scene. And inside of this, we have some lights, a camera, and this reference node. Now, the reference node is just bringing in some geometry. This is bringing in some lights. And this is just our camera. So we have our geometry, our three lights, and our camera all being brought and merged in. And then we have this Karma final node over here. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to remove everything. I'm going to remove everything, and we're going to rebuild that. To start with, we have our geometry. Now, what I would suggest doing is setting up your camera first. So what you can do is just go into your view over here, set up a camera where you feel that it fits best. An interesting thing that you can do is you can double middle mouse on a particular object in the scene or a particular surface, and it'll center on it, and then you can zoom out from there. So say we want to focus on this pawn in the middle, we can double middle mouse and then zoom out. So something like that. And that positions us fairly nicely, fairly centrally on that piece. Under the LARP lights and cameras tab at the top left, we can control and left click on camera to drop a camera. A nice change that they've made in 19 is that when you drop a camera, if you are locked to view, so when you move around, the camera moves with it, it now has this red, which is really nice because sometimes I would move a camera and not realize that I'd have it locked and I would just ruin a camera. Maybe I'm an idiot, but this is a great feature. I really like this. So if you want to make any changes to your camera, you can go to your view mode and just move around until you're happy with your camera. After that, switch off that lock and that red goes away. It's an awesome little piece that they've added. So something interesting is that when you create this camera node, it will actually create a camera's primitive path for you. As you can see over here, there's cameras and we have camera one inside of it. Now, that is driven by this primitive path over here. So you have /cameras/$OS, $OS just being this node's name. So this could be main camera or something, and it would change in your scene over here. And so because of the way that the scene graph is set up, you can actually just separate these and then merge them together. And I find that this keeps things a little bit easier to follow because you have your geometry coming in from one side and your camera coming in from another. And as you'll see now, when we add lights, we can do the same thing. So if we go to the viewport render mode, right, and we take a look at this render, we're going to have a pretty boring render. And that's just because we don't really have any lights in the scene as of yet. So by default, it does add this single sort of spotlight from camera view. And it does this in Mantra as well. So before, when you used to render with no lights in your scene, it always used to just add this light that's pointing from the camera. It gives you this very flat view. What we're going to do is we're going to drop an environment light. So you can just control and left click on environment light that can add it to the origin, or you can click on it and then press enter to just place it at origin. Once again, removing it from the natural sort of singular chain and adding it into the merge node. Again, this is going to create a path called /lights/$OS. So the node name. And if we take a look down here, we have lights, dome light one. And this is really nice because it keeps everything really neat. When you're working, you have your cameras, you have your lights, and you have your geometry, right? And so in this case, I'm just going to call this ambient, and I'm going to find a texture to use for this. So if you go into the $hip and into the textures, you'll find this Photo Studio London Hall. And this is from HDRI Haven. If you haven't checked them out, I highly suggest you check them out. They are also now doing something called Polyhaven, I believe. And so they have a bunch of assets for artists to download, including HDRIs and geometry that's free to use in your project. So this is just one of the HDRIs that I grabbed from there. So now we have this light being brought in and our camera. We want to add some more interesting lights. So let's go ahead and add a light above our scene. So let's imagine that this is at some sort of chess tournament and we have lights above. So I'm going to go ahead and drop a spotlight directly above. And if we go back to our camera view and then move our spotlight into this chain of lights, we can take a look at what that looks like over here. So as you would usually work, you can bypass a light. So what you can do is you can change color temperature over here if you don't want to change color. Color temperature, the lower you go, the warmer the light gets. The higher you go, the cooler the light gets. So about 3.2, I believe, is like daylight. So that's just a nice warm spotlight. And we can increase this just to see what it's doing for us. And it's just giving us a fairly uniform light from above. I'm going to drop this back down, and that should be fine. Right, so let's add something a bit more interesting. Let's also just add a light that is a bit of a room light. So we're going to go behind our pieces over here, and we can add an area light that acts as a room light. So just like this, dropping an area light, going to the karma view, and then going to our main camera. And if we just drop this in over here, we now have a nice chain of lights. And if you'd like your node connectors to look like this, you can press Shift S to switch between the default and this rounded style. Now we have this light coming in from the side over there. And of course, we can make adjustments to it if we wish. And the nice thing is we now have live view. So Karma's live view is now a lot more stable and a lot easier to use. So we can adjust lights in real time. So that's all well and good, right? We have some basic lights set up, but this isn't really the power of using Solaris. So where exactly does all of the new interesting features come in? Well, for one, we can add an IES light. IES stands for Illuminating Engineering Society. The idea was to use it to distribute photometric data. What this basically means is you can make a pretty looking light that provides realistic patterns when it shines. Now, as you might imagine, if you have, for example, a torch and you shine it, the light isn't just a circle, right? It's not a perfect circle. You have sort of bright areas within it, and you have this variation in shape. This is pretty cool because you can actually download a bunch of IES profiles from the Pixar RenderMan website. And so they give you a whole pack of IES profiles, and it is public domain. So I have included it in the file. You will find it in the textures IES. Okay, so to use an IES light, we can go ahead and jump over to our spotlight over here, and we're going to switch to the view from that light. So let's look through that light and go to spotlight. Now, as you can see, it is a very uniform light, and we can maybe better see this light if we just disable our other lights. So I'm just going to bypass our two lights over here. So we're only focusing on our spotlight. Now, if we take a look at what the spotlight does, because of the ground, it may be a little bit hard to tell, but it's fairly uniform. If we go over here to our shaping node and down to the bottom, you'll notice that we have this IES option. From here, we can go find a file, and if we go into our textures, IES, we can find a particular IES shape. So let's go ahead and choose tight focused. And if we go into that file, you'll notice that there's a .json file and two PNGs. So the PNGs are just previews. What you actually want is this .ies. So we're going to select that and it'll be blown out. We're going to go over and adjust our exposure, just bringing it down. And what you'll notice is that there's an interesting shaping to our light. And so perhaps in this situation, it may not be as noticeable as you may think. But what we can do is we can move this light over to the side and angle it, and we may be able to notice the shape a bit better. So if we take a look at this right now, we can go ahead and change the shaping on this to something else. Let's try a medium scatter and then increase this exposure. You can see that the shaping of this light is different. And so this is interesting because IES wasn't available to us before. And this is something that can add a lot of realism to a shot. So let's take a look at the three lobe, dropping exposure again. And as you can see, we end up with some really interesting shaping. That shaping over there is pretty nice, right? So you have this outside light over there and this brighter spot towards the center. So all of this is great. Like I love working with IES, and you can do some really cool lighting setups with IES. So it's nice to know that it is now in Houdini. I'm going to re-enable our other two lights. And let's go back to our main camera. So now that we have that light, perhaps there's too much brightness, right? But which light is the issue, and how do we really adjust these in a meaningful way? Well, there's an awesome little tool that you can use in Solaris called the light mixer. So go ahead and drop down a light mixer, and this just goes in after your lights over here. And what you'll notice is that it picks up all of your lights. If we go ahead and select all of them, you can select one at a time or hold shift and select all of them. You can drag them over, and over here, all of the information about those lights are available to you. Now, this is incredibly powerful because what you can do from here is you can adjust the lights from here and even adjust them through sliders. So let's go ahead to our attributes. And let's say that we want to drop the exposure of our spotlight. We can go ahead and just drag that down. And if we want to adjust our area light, we can do the same. And as you can see, we've made changes now. And you'll notice that there's also this little red dot. That just lets you know that this light mixer has made changes. You can right click on this and just say revert to default, right? So we can revert these to defaults. So in this case, I would like our area light and our spotlight to be a bit less. So I'm going to drop our area light and our spotlight. Now, I think it would be interesting to have our area light a different color. So what happens if we had to make it a blue color? And so now we have that sort of blue in the back over there, and you can still make changes to the actual light itself. We can move it around. If we just take a look at where it is, you can see exactly where that blue light is. Perhaps we'll move it up here. And just do something like that. So through this light mixer, we can control things and we can view it in real time over here. Now let's say that I think that this lighting is interesting, but I would like to make changes and try some other things out before I settle. What I can do is bring up this over here, and this is where all of your snapshots are stored. So if we go ahead and click on snapshot, it'll take a snapshot of the scene, and then we can make changes. So let's say I want to try this sort of orangish color. And then with that, I want to do a bit of a teal color. And now I'm kind of interested in this lighting, right? What I can do is I can add another snapshot. And again, I can adjust all of these. So perhaps I want to revert these to default. And I really want to try a more dramatic approach. So I decrease the ambient light in the scene over here so that it's much more dramatic. And then I take a snapshot of that. And then I realize that, you know what, I really like the color where I had the orange and the teal. What you can do is you can go down to your snapshots and you can revisit this one over here. But the other thing that you can do is you can right click on it and say revert network to this snapshot. And so all of the settings that you changed to have that snapshot can be reverted, and all of your settings will go back to how they were. Now, this isn't specific to the light mixer. You could have added nodes, removed nodes, you could have rotated lights, you could have done anything and then reverted back to the snapshot and it'll be exactly as it was. So one quick side note about snapshots is that you can also now render to background. So if you click on this background render, it'll make a snapshot that renders while you're working. So you can continue working, and while you're working, it'll be creating that snapshot. Right. So if we take a look over here, we can view this image. And as you can see, it's still rendering. If you want to add a second one, it will give you this warning. And you can change the number of background renders that you can run by increasing the number of parallel renders over here. One thing about doing that is that it does become very intensive because you can be running multiple background renders. If you'd like to stop a render, you can just right click on it over here and go to stop render. And so this is now just a pretty interesting option where you can make changes in your scene. And once again, just add it to this background render snapshots. So just thought I would mention that before continuing on with the tutorial. And so I'm going to go to this more dramatic one because that's actually the one that I kind of like. And then make a few more changes. So I'll bring the ambience up a little bit, something like that. And there are some other controls on the light mixer, but I'm not going to get into it too much. I think that that gives you a fairly good understanding of the light mixer. So that's it for this part. I just wanted to show you how you can add lights, adjust lights, good ways of setting up your Solaris scene to make it easy to use, how you can mix lights with your light mixer, have snapshots, and switch between those snapshots. We also went over the IES light, which is a new feature for shaping lights, and basically just how to get your scene into a position where you can render it from. And really, that's what's going to be next. In the next part, we're going to actually look at render settings, some camera settings, how you can do things like depth of field, and how we can do more specific render settings based on a scene like this, where we have multiple different things going on, right? We have transmission, we have some subsurf, we have metallics, we have this bright light on the side, we have multiple light sources. We're going to explore all of those different things in the next part. So I hope to see you there. And I hope that this part was helpful. I'll see you next time.